Then the king called together all the elders of Judah and Jerusalem. He went up to the temple of the Lord with the people of Judah, the inhabitants of Jerusalem, the priests and the prophets, all the people from the least to the greatest. He read in their hearing all the words of the book of the covenant which had been found in the temple of the Lord. The king stood by the pillar and renewed the covenant in the presence of the Lord, to follow the Lord and to keep his commands, statutes, and decrees with all his heart and with all his soul, thus confirming the words of the covenant written in this book. Then all the people pledged themselves to the covenant. This is the reading of the Word of God.
That is the last time that, or at least the last Sunday, that you'll see that graphic as I'm concluding this series that I started the last Sunday in January, this series called The Royals. It has been a survey primarily of 1st and 2nd Samuel and 1st and 2nd Kings, honing in on Saul, honing in on David, especially. Last week we talked about Saul. And you might remember last week in our discussion of Solomon, along with his father David, we kind of gave him a little bit of a bad time. Kind of gave both of those men a lot of grief. We talked a little bit about the ways that they honored and glorified God, and we talked a little bit about some of the ways that God used them, but mostly we talked about their drift. And truth be told, that's because in the accounts of their reigns and in the accounts of their lives, the majority of the ink is spent on their drifts. And while all that is true, David and Solomon did indeed drift, sometimes in very dramatic ways. In other ways, you haven't seen anything yet. You haven't seen anything yet, because after Solomon's reign, Solomon is recorded in the first 11 chapters of 1 Kings, but then the remainder of 1 Kings and all of 2 Kings is about all of the kings, 40 of them, that came after Solomon. Now, maybe there were so many kings because after Solomon, the kingdom was split in two. You had Israel to the north, and you had Judah, what would be called Judea in Jesus' time, to the south. And each kingdom, each part of the former united kingdom had a king, had a separate king. And so there were many. There were many from the time of David and Solomon up until the exile, up until they were conquered and the leaders and rulers and leading families were made to go off into a different kingdom, Babylon and Assyria. Now, all of these kings that came after Solomon, I say you haven't seen anything yet, because all of these kings that came after Solomon have a common description. If you were to have your Bible open and you were sort of scanning the pages of all these different kings, and you could do that because all of their names are listed on the subheads and the headings that you find in so many of today's Bibles, like NIV study Bibles and that sort of thing. So you could kind of get the gist. You could kind of see the names as you went through the remainder of 1 Kings and all of 2 Kings. But you would also find something else. You would find a common phrase, and that common phrase was, it would introduce the king, and then it says, and he did evil in the sight of the Lord. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord. That's true of all of them, except one. The king that Steve read just a little bit about in 2 Kings 23, Josiah. Josiah comes along way later, many, many years, hundreds of years after Solomon. And before the portion that Steve read, there's this interesting thing that happens. They are in the temple looking for something else, actually looking for something related to the treasury and an accounting of the treasury. And while they are looking, some of the officials in Josiah's court, while they are looking, they stumble upon the book of the law. And Josiah is very impressed by this, and this gets his attention, especially after he reads it. A couple of things that I want you to miss. First of all, what does it say that the book of the law was lost to begin with? Okay? It says a lot, because not only was the book lost, but so much faithfulness and so much obedience to the book of the law was also lost during these times and during all of these 40 or so kings' reigns. But they found it. They found the book of the law, and this was very exciting for Josiah. And so, yes, the covenant was renewed. This promise, this agreement that we talked about as part of this series, that if you will be faithful and obedient, walk in the ways of the Lord, then God's promise is that God will be faithful. Steady was a word that Steve used during the invocation this morning. I like that. That's kind of like a modern take on the biblical word steadfast. That is true. That is God's promise. That is God's character. And the covenant is that if the people will be faithful and obedient, that God will be true to his character. God will be faithful and obedient to the people. But the kings and the people, they didn't keep their end of the covenants all that often. That's true of Saul and David. Solomon's reign, to some extent, especially true to these later kings. They did evil in the eyes of the Lord. They had their moments. They had their moments, like Josiah renewing the covenants, like Solomon building the temple, the house of God, like David bringing the Ark of the Covenant into Jerusalem. They had their moments, but for the most part, as we have said time and time again during this series, for the most part, these kings were so broken, so prone to corruption, so prone to temptation. These kings were so insecure. These kings were so human. These kings were so human because that's all they were. They were just kings. They were not the King of Kings. They were not the King of Kings. And that is going to be our final word. And that is going to be our final reflection in this series on the royals, is a little bit of discussion around Jesus the Christ, the Son of the living God, Lord and Savior of the world, and King of Kings. You know, Jesus has come up already in this series a couple of times, several times. He's prone to do that anytime you are studying the Old Testament. He's come up specifically during this series, the Sunday that I talked about David's anointing. Do you remember that? How Samuel went to find the next king because Saul was not at all measuring up. And he thought it would be one of Jesse's older sons. But actually it was the one who wasn't even there at the time, the one who was off in the field shepherding or doing something like that. And the reason that it surprised everyone there, including Samuel the prophet, is given in 1 Samuel 6. It says, God does not look at the outward appearance. God looks at the heart. And so that Sunday when we were talking about the heart, I recalled or reminded you that so very often that was a big part of Jesus' teachings too. Jesus was very interested in the heart. And that came that came out in his stories and in his parables and his teachings and his time while he was here on earth. He talked a lot about the heart. Jesus was also mentioned the Sunday that we talked about David and Jonathan. David and Jonathan, that Sunday I said, lo and behold, right in the middle of a study on the ancient kings, foreign things, seemingly, from faraway places, seemingly, right smack dab in a study on the ancient Israelite monarchy, we have a lesson on friendship. A lesson on friendship. And I said, you know what, actually Jesus had some things to say about friendship as well. In John 15, Jesus elevates friendship. Jesus elevates friendship and says that it inhabits the same sphere as obedience and service and love. That where you find those things, you find rich ground, rich and fertile ground for deep, lasting, and genuine friendship. So Jesus has already come up several times in this particular series. And this is a probably an appropriate time, whether it really is or not, I'm going to do it anyway, to remind you what I remind you, I know, fairly regularly, but if we are going to call Jesus King of Kings, one of the things that means is the thing that I say every so often. There is no pill. There is no platform. There is no policy. There is no program. There is no person that can save you. Only the love of God in Jesus Christ can do that. I'm feeling compelled to say that again because now I need to add something to that list. Neither can palaces. Neither can palaces. Actually, I thought of something else. I was reminded of something else in this whole conversation that about ancient Israelite kings that leads us to the King of Kings. And that's a little passage of scripture from one of my favorite books of the Bible, from the book of Philippians. I want to read this to you. It's from Philippians chapter 3, starting in verse 7. But whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss. This is Paul talking. Whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith. I want to know Christ and the power of the resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in His sufferings, becoming like Him in His death, and so somehow to attain to the resurrection from the dead. I love, love, love that passage for at least a couple of reasons. First of all, I love how Paul uses the word somehow. Somehow. He lists what comes from knowing Christ, and then at the end he says, and somehow I will participate in the resurrection through this. It's almost like Paul is saying, you know what, I don't have it all figured out. I just know that all hope and all power and all salvation is found in Jesus Christ. I love that. I also love the word rubbish. Love the word rubbish. Do you remember how I said that? I consider them rubbish, that I may gain Christ and be found in Him. Okay. Every now and then, there's a word that in the original language is much better than how we try to translate it in English. This is an example. Okay, the Greek word here is the word skubal. That's just fun to say. Scuba. I think we should have left that word in our English Bibles, actually. It means rubbish, but as with so many of the original words, that is not an altogether complete translation. It means waste. It is actually, in its original language, a word that you probably wouldn't say around children. He's using strong language here, is the point I'm trying to make. Scuba. It's all just rubbish. It's all just garbage. It's all just waste. I love that. And I'm reminded of this passage because when I think about everything we've talked about and everything we've worked through and everything we've studied in this study of Saul and David and Solomon, I think so much of it is actually just rubbish. It's actually just rubbish. Do you remember? Go back all the way back to the beginning. In 1 Samuel chapter 8, we began this series with the people telling the prophet Samuel, "We want a king. We want to be just like all the other nations." And Samuel says, "Okay, if you get a king, here's what's going to happen." I hope you noticed throughout the series that what he warned them is exactly what happened. So, to have a king, rubbish. To have all the armor and go and fight all the battles and do all that needs to be done as part of having a kingdom, rubbish. 12,000 chariots and 14,000 horses, scuba. Goblets made of gold and Solomon in all his splendor, rubbish. It is. It just simply is. Compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus, the King of Kings. And so I would ask you to conclude this series, church. Do you know of that surpassing greatness? Do you know Christ Jesus? Sounds like a preacher question to a congregation on a Sunday. It might even sound like a bit of a silly question, but I don't think so. I don't think so. And here's why. Here's why I don't think it's silly. Because you may have gone to church your whole life. You may be in Sunday school or in youth group just about every Sunday. You may serve in the community nonstop. It does not necessarily mean, if you do those things, it does not necessarily mean that Jesus is king of your heart or Jesus is king of your life. If you remember anything from this series, remember that for God, it's all about the heart. It's all about the heart. And so as I reflect on this idea further, I'm thinking to myself, okay, Brian, you're going to ask faithful, church-going people, is Jesus Christ Lord of their life and Lord of their heart? And so it occurs to me, if there's anyone in the room, if there's anyone listening that is perhaps thinking, answering, contemplating, reflecting and thinking, I don't know, I think there's probably reasons for that. Legitimate reasons, like doubt, for instance. I understand that. I understand that sometimes we doubt our faith or sometimes we have things that cause us to doubt our faith. That's legitimate. Our book group on Wednesdays has a great author, Timothy Keller. We're about to do a study of one of his books, Shameless Plug. And one of the things that he says again and again is that's fine for people of faith to question their faith. But if you do that, question your doubt as well. If you're going to be skeptical, question that skepticism and then see where that journey leads you. I love that. Or maybe it's not doubt. Maybe for you, it's anger. It's anger. Something has happened in the life of your faith or in your journey with God that has made you angry, or something's just happened in your life that's made you angry with God. I know that happens a lot. That's fine too. That's understandable too. You know who else would say that's fine and understandable? The psalmist. psalm after psalm after psalm does a lot of, well, what I would call venting. Venting, letting God have it. Trust me, God can handle it. But what you'll find in those psalms is that the psalmist always returns to praise. Always returns to praise. Maybe it's not doubt. Maybe it's not anger. Maybe it's fear that's keeping you from putting Jesus on the throne. I get that too. Especially in this day and age, it is hard to let go of control. And if we're going to put Jesus on the throne, that means we can't sit there. It may be the hardest part of faith to surrender. To really, truly surrender. So maybe it's doubt, maybe it's anger, maybe it's fear, or maybe it's just that you don't know. You just don't know. And so, to make Jesus truly King of Kings, King of your life, King of your heart, I just don't know. Well, to that I would say, yes, you do. You do. If you have at some point or another suspected that this searching is just going to lead to more searching, and these things that you try to put on the throne and try to have lead your life, whether that's something else or whether that's just yourself, if you suspected that those things are just going to keep you searching or just going to keep you empty, let me confirm that suspicion. They are. They are. They will leave you empty. Jesus never will. They will leave you doubting. They will not ultimately bring about peace, but Jesus will. He is the Prince of Peace, in addition to being Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And while we're at it, He is the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. He is the bright and morning star. He is the writer called Faithful and True. He is the Alpha and the Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He is the way, and He is the truth, and He is the light. He is King of Kings, and He is Lord of Lords. And you know what? If you make a king of your life and king of your heart, you become a king or a queen. You inherit the riches, abundant, eternal life that is found in knowing, following, serving, believing in, and worshiping Jesus Christ. Through God's amazing grace, unbelievable power, and incredible love for you, you become royal. If you have never done that, if there is something that has kept you from doing that, from putting Jesus on the throne, saying you are King of Kings, you are King of my life, you are King of my heart, what are you waiting for? Why not now? You know, don't you? It's all true. Let's pray. I don't have anything else to add, God. I just pray that you work in these hearts and minds. And that if there is doubt or anger or fear or confusion or questioning or anything else that is keeping them from putting you first, from understanding that you really are the King of Kings, that today would be the day that they let go of that, that they surrender, put you on the throne as we stand and sing together. Let's stand and sing together.